yes, he washed me with his mercy, and he cleansed me in his blood. Now I stand complete, I have been set free, I found life there in that flood. Not the same, I am changed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. By his grace, I am saved, I'm his child forever. Satisfied by the precious blood of Christ.
Not the same, I am changed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. By his grace, I am saved, I'm his child forever. I am, hallelujah, redeemed. Shine in glorious light. When he calls me home, I'll fall at his throne and forever worship Christ. I'll forever worship Christ.
Good morning, everybody. As you make your way to your seats, we just have a few announcements. I'll try to slow it down enough to give everybody just time to sit down, but not so long that you've lost attention, I hope. But we don't have very many announcements, but there is a lot going on in the church, and most of it is in the bulletin. So take a minute to look at your bulletin and all the events that are coming up. I would like to remind everybody that we're going to have a quick members meeting right after church. And if everyone would just stay in place, we'll do that. If you're a visitor, you're welcome to stay as well. So we'll conduct a brief business session at the close. You all should have a bulletin, and in that bulletin, you probably get a bulletin with a pen. You're welcome to keep the pen. That's our gift to you. But we would ask that you fill out one of these cards. Now, I've heard people say, well, I did that last week. That's okay. Do it again this week. Just if you're a member with nothing new to add, just put your name on it and somebody will be collecting at the end. If you're new to the church and a visitor and you would like one, we have a visitor's gift for everybody. If you stop at the Welcome Center, you can pick up your gift, and we'd like to get some information from you. If you're just visiting, like some of the Southwells from Evergreen, if you're just visiting here for one day and don't plan to come back, just say hi to people, fill out a card. We're not going to bug you. Well, we might. Our reading today, scripture reading today, comes from Revelation chapter 4, the first 11 verses. After this, I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice, which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet, said, come up here, and I will show you what must take place for this. At once I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne stood in heaven, and with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian, and around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. Around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments with gold crowns on their heads. From the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder, and before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was, as it were, a sea of glass like crystal. And around the throne, on each side of the throne, are four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with the face of a man, and the fourth living creature like an eagle in flight. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within, and day and night they never cease to say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they exist and were created.
All right, good morning. Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time to come and worship you and learn from your word. Lord, we pray that you would just have your way among us here this morning, and that you would transform us to look more like you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Go ahead and stand and join with us. Stretched thin, he's faithful, and we can still continue to praise our God.
Your name, blessed be the name. Oh, you give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Well, as Don was reading this morning, I was just struck by those words. And when God is there seated on his throne and the elders are there and they cast down their crowns before the throne and they say, worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things and by your will they existed and were created. And so as we sing this next song, let's consider freshly the power and the immenseness of this God. I'm just struck when it says these flashes of lightning, the peals of thunder that just thunder in your chest, right? This is a powerful God that we serve. And this God is so merciful and gracious that he spared not his son to come and redeem us from the mess that we made. So let's sing together, How Great Thou Art.
Christ shall come with shouts, acclamation, and lead me home. Joy should fill my heart. Then I shall bow with humble adoration, and then proclaim, my God, I'm great, thou worth. Then sings my soul, my Savior.
Wise man who built his house on the rock, and the rain fell and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, but it did not fall because it had been founded on the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not build their house, it is like a foolish man who builds his house on the sand, and the rain fell and the floods came, the winds blew against that house, and it fell, and great was its fall.
Mine hope is built in nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name.
In this life, no matter what storms rage against us, the winds they blow, the rain beats against us, Lord, but we can be confident that our anchor will hold. No matter what happens, no matter how crazy and insane this world becomes, our hope, our strength, our peace, our source of life is found in you. Lord, we pray that you would have your way here among us this morning. Sanctify us by the preaching of your word, that we would look more like you as a result of our time together this morning than what we did when we came in. Pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Children could be dismissed at this time. I want to pray specifically for one of our own, Lisa Hartzell, as most of you know through the prayer chain, is having some very extreme struggles right now with anxiety. And I talked with Jeff last night, and he said, would you please let our people know that don't stop praying. She needs your prayers. She's having these anxiety attacks every 15 minutes or so and is not able to sleep. And so our hearts go out to Jeff and Lisa. I want to just take a moment to pray for them right now. Also, just to acknowledge Levi Holmes with us today, successful surgery on Wednesday, and praise God for his work in Levi's life as well. Let's just pray. God, we thank you that though you are such a great God, you are also such an intimate God. You are a God that cares about, who cares about the details of our lives. And we know that the Bible states that we are commanded to cast all of our care upon him because he cares for you. And We think of Jeff and Lisa at this time and the difficulties that they are facing, the challenges that they are facing with this situation. And Father, many of us have felt similar things in this life, overwhelming sense of fear, anxiety, worry. Lord, we just lift up our sister to you and her husband as he comes alongside her and helps her through this time, and the whole Hartzell family at this time. And we want to pray in a way that is a blessing to them, Father. And so may we continue on lifting up Lisa in our prayers. We do thank you for the successful surgery with Levi Holmes and a load lifted off the Holmes family there this week. And we commit this time into your hands as we look into your word in the book of Esther. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. How many of you would like a fish story this morning? Raise your hand if you'd like a fish story. At least a few of you. That's pretty good. Better response than a baseball story. So I'm going to tell you a quick fish story. We were up in Canada. I was with my son Gabriel and Roger Leach, who's here this morning. And Roger is a master at fishing. He actually has a bumper sticker that says, "Fish tremble at the sound of my name." I think that's true. Craig, you can buy that bumper sticker anytime as well. "Fish do not tremble at the sound of my name. I'm not very good at it." And I had hooked into this walleye, and I was reeling as fast as I could and just reeling this thing in. And it was a monster, wasn't it, Roger? I mean, at least 22 inches. I don't know if it was that big. But it was a big walleye, the biggest one I had ever landed. And it made one last final dive as we got to the boat, and it saw the net, and it dove under, and I pulled, and guess what happened? Yeah, gone. Trophy fish gone. Well, here on the pages of Scripture, if you want to just think about Esther as in the process of reeling in a trophy walleye, some of you have fought to reel in a salmon or a trout in the springtime, and that's an interesting thing because you have to walk along up, you'll have to walk the river to tire out the fish, and if you stand and just pull, it's not going to work. So you work with the fish and you walk along, and it's a patient process. That's kind of what we see here in Esther chapter 5. She is in a bit of a spot here. She's going to have to manipulate some things. She's going to have to react in a very wise way. We left her in a situation last week, chapter 4, verse 11. "All the king's servants," she says to Mordecai, "and the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law to be put to death, except the one to whom the king holds out the golden scepter so that he may live." Then Mordecai sets her straight there and says, "If you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place, but you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not come to the kingdom for such a time as this?" And then, of course, the famous words from Esther's lips. "Then I will go," verse 16, "then I will go to the king, though it is against the law, and if I perish, I perish." So we pick up the story then in chapter 5 and verse 1. "On the third day, Esther put on her royal robes and stood in the inner court of the king's palace in front of the king's quarters, while the king was sitting on his royal throne inside the throne room opposite the entrance to the palace. And when the king saw Queen Esther standing in the court, she won favor in his sight, and he held out to Esther the golden scepter that was in his hand. Then Esther approached and touched the tip of the scepter. And the king said to her, 'What is it, Queen Esther? What is your request? It shall be given you, even to half of my kingdom.' And Esther said, 'If it please the king, let the king and Haman come today to a feast that I have prepared for the king.' Then the king said, 'Bring Haman quickly so that we may do as Esther has asked. So the king and Haman came to the feast and Esther had prepared, and as they were drinking wine after the feast, the king said to Esther, "What is your wish? It shall be granted you, and what is your request? Even to the half of my kingdom it shall be fulfilled." Then Esther answered, "My wish and my request is, if I have found favor in the sight of the king, and if it please the king to grant my wish and fulfill my request, let the king and Haman come to the feast that I will prepare for them, and tomorrow I will do as the king has said." And Haman went out that day joyful and glad of heart. But when Haman saw Mordecai in the king's gate, that he neither rose nor trembled before him, he was filled with wrath against Mordecai. Nevertheless, Haman restrained himself and went home, and he sent and brought his friends and his wife Zeresh. And Haman recounted to them the splendor of his riches, the number of his sons, all the promotions with which the king had honored him, and how he had advanced him above the officials and the servants of the king. Then Haman said, "Even Queen Esther let no one but me come with the king to the feast she prepared, and tomorrow also I am invited by her together with the king. Yet all this is worth nothing to me so long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate." Then his wife Zeresh and all his friends said to him, "Let a gallows 50 cubits high be made, and in the morning tell the king to have Mordecai hanged upon it. Then go joyfully with the king to the feast." This idea pleased Haman, and he had the gallows made. Well, if you're a TV watcher, if you have a show or two that you watch, what is it that brings you back, that leaves you panting for more? Most of the time now we can go and just do episode one, episode two, and so on and so forth. But back to the days where these TV shows were rolled out, whether it was Magnum PI or Simon and Simon or whatever, Matlock or whatever show it was that you watched, what's the one by the lady, Murder, She Wrote, right? They left you at a cliffhanger if they wanted to get you back. And that's what we have here on the pages of Scripture. So my first point is resolving the cliffhanger. We were left at chapter 4 with what in the world is going to happen to Esther as she plays this game of Russian roulette. Excavations uncovered depictions of the Persian king as he sat on his throne, holding his scepter, flanked by various officials, and one of those officials, if we can trust the depictions, was a man with an axe. And they think, historians think, that the reason for that axe was in those cases where the king said, "No, I'm not going to extend my scepter to you, it gets withheld from you," that person was dealt with swiftly and effectively. It's a sense of risk for Esther. Think about who she is approaching. This is a king who's not necessarily known for his stability, is he? He's rather moody. Is he in a generous mood today, or is he in an irritable mood today? Which one of his counselors, if any, is he going to listen to? And she has to take steps of faith. We have to take steps of faith when we're called upon by God to move in a direction of courage, in a direction of conviction, in a direction of boldness, in a direction whereby we're willing to take some risks for God's kingdom. And we have to take steps of faith if we're going to move in shrewdness as well. We think just of Esther as a piece of clay in the hands of God, and how far she's come in these past 5 years since she became Queen Esther. She's come a long way, hasn't she? Back in the early pages of the book, she's kind of moving in a direction of just wanting to assimilate, wanting to become part of the culture. She gains this great position as Queen Esther in a rather dubious way, and now God has brought her to this point in history for a specific purpose. Will she be able to pull off her call as a small s savior of her people. And verse 1 hammers home Esther's precarious position. If you look at it in the Hebrew, it repeats a Hebrew root word that is usually, it's the word malkuth, which can be translated royal or palace. And this word is used no less than 6 times in this one verse. Listen to what Brian Gregory says. It is as if the narrator is piling up references to royalty to emphasize the magnitude of the authority and power that Esther will be confronting. This is a powerful man that she stands before. And in chapter 2, it's interesting how she entered his bedroom to seduce and to pleasure the king and win the contest and become the queen. And here, she has a sense of decorum. She knows that it's time to pull out all the stops, and she comes dressed in her royal robes that shouts out to the king, "This is not just any woman. This is your queen." And she stands there silently outside of the king's throne room, hoping to be noticed by him. We don't know how long she waits, but she stands there waiting, 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 perhaps with the words that she has uttered, "If I perish, I perish," still in her head. And the readers breathe a collective sigh of relief. One of the challenges as we read the Bible is, as best we can, to pretend that we don't know what happens next. Right? If you could go back and not know what happens next, and you come to verses 1 and 2, and you can picture King Ahasuerus extending the scepter to Esther, we can all breathe now, right? Our heroine is safe for now. It's interesting, too, that this phrase, "she won favor in his sight," it's not the first time that we've found this in regards to Esther. Back in chapter 2, verse 9, she actively won favor in the sight of the head eunuch. And here, she actively wins favor in the sight of the king. And that's important for the reader to know, because it's kind of leading us in a direction where it's not just a little sigh of relief, it's a big sigh of relief, isn't it? She has won favor in the sight of the king. Second point then, back to our fishing analogy, hooking the big one. As she hooks or reels in the big one, it's reeling in the big one. These are outdated notes from earlier in the week. Reeling in the big one. She's won such great favor in his sight that he's presented her with this blank check. I received a blank check from someone the other day. "You fill in the amount," was what he said. It's kind of cool. Of course, I didn't abuse that, Jerry, don't worry. But it's kind of cool to receive a blank check. And this is a king who, he issues blank checks on a regular basis. In chapter 3, he issued a blank check to Haman, and Haman filled in the amount, didn't he? To have the Jews slaughtered. And here's a blank check for Esther. 127 divided by 2. That's how many provinces are in this kingdom. 127 provinces. If you divide that by 2, he says half the kingdom. She would be in charge of 63.5 provinces. And that is no small thing. He doesn't know she's Jewish. For a Jewish woman to have that much power, it's a hint of the changing of the guard. It's a hint of a great shift in power structures here in this Persian Empire. We wonder, too, was this tempting for Esther? Was it tempting for her to say, "Boy, here and now, I'll take those 63.5 provinces. Let's forget about my people. This is all about me." if she pushes her chips to the middle of the poker table, she may be making a great mistake. If she moves too quickly, she has to patiently reel in this trophy fish. She's not out of the woods yet. There's the thorny issue of Haman's edict, in which the Jews are to be destroyed within the calendar year. There's, number two, there's this sense of once the signet ring has come down on a particular pronouncement, there's no way to reverse that. And there's the thorny issue of the fact that for 5 years plus, she has not filled the king in on one little fact. I'm Jewish. And in the course of this whole thing, she's going to have to do that. And typically, husbands slash people don't respond well when they find out that they have been deceived about something for 5 years running. It's a fragile situation. She has to handle it with care. And so she appeals to something that is right up the king's alley. A feast. She's already planned this feast. And ironically, the king and his sidekick Haman have the feast thing mastered, don't they? That's the one thing that these two fellows do really well. They feast. They know how to party. The feast is already prepared. Ironically, the king and Haman here both act according to the word of Esther. Well, the careful reader goes back in their minds to Esther chapter 1, verse 22. What's wrong with this picture? He sent letters to all the royal provinces, to every province in its own script, and to every people in its own language, that every man be master in his own household. And here, Esther is calling the shots. Esther chapter 5, verse 6. She's slowly reeling in that big fish. She can't be too quick about this. As they were drinking wine after the feast, the king said to Esther, "What is your wish? It shall be granted you. And what is your request? Even to half of my kingdom, it shall be fulfilled." Then Esther answered, "My wish and my request is," and it's almost like in the Hebrew there's a pause, almost as if she is ready to launch into her request about the saving of her people. And she backs off from it. And she simply invites the two men to another feast, same time, same place, another feast. And they're the only two people invited to this feast. We're not sure why she backs off. Is it just not the right moment? Does Esther lose her nerve? Does she need a little bit more time to gain a little bit more courage? Raise your hand if you felt that way. Wow, confident people. We only have a few hands up. Or we have a lot of sleepers. I don't know. One frog to swallow in one day is usually enough for me. Maybe she doesn't want to swallow another frog. We can't be totally sure. I lean in this direction, that this is all part of her brilliant plan to continue to reel in this trophy fish. It's a calculated move to whet the king's appetite for this grand revealing of her wish and request. People love mystery, don't they? People love to be kept in suspense. Unless you're from a Dutch community. My wife tells me she doesn't like surprises. But most people love the sense of mystery around this situation. And the reader already knows that Esther has found favor, that it does please the king to grant her wish. Maybe when everything comes out in the wash, she makes it easy for him. A second feast on the next day. She has brilliantly secured an advanced commitment to his granting her wish and fulfilling her request. Brian Gregory writes this, and it's helpful. Just by showing up, the king will have already implicitly committed to grant it. He's virtually obligated now to do this. And she secured something else very important. She has secured the presence of Haman at the feast. Why is this important? Because she needs to be able to spring it on the king, what Haman has done, in time and space, and surprise him that Haman's the man, and if Haman's not there, what's going to happen? She's going to present her case. The king's going to go to Haman. Hey, what's your side to the story? And there's all kinds of risks there. And so she has brilliantly crafted this in such a way that the king is in a spot here. And just as Proverbs 16:33 earlier, we referred to that, taught us this, the lot is cast into the lap, but its every decision is from the Lord. So we are taught now the truth of Proverbs 21, verse 1, which, by the way, is your memory verse in your connection card. Love this verse. Gives me a great deal of comfort in a troubled world. The king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. He turns it wherever he will. God is sovereign, and we can trust him. Third point then, riding the roller coaster. Riding the roller coaster. Haman exits the palace with wine on his lips and joy and gladness in his heart. The Jerusalem Publication Society Bible puts it this way in their translation. That day Haman went out happy and lighthearted. His ego balloon is full of helium. He is riding high. He's walking on air, however you want to put it. Flattery is music to this man's ears. Not only is the queen, the king in his back pocket, but now the queen is in his back pocket as well. He is a rising star. How much better can life get? And then we read that little word, but. Guess who he has to pass on his way home out of the palace? His archenemy, Mordecai. And Mordecai has upped the ante of his boycott, his Haman boycott, hasn't he? Not only will he not bow when Haman comes through, now he won't rise and bow when Haman comes through. That's what they would do typically when royalty came through. They would rise and then they would bow. Not only will he not rise and bow, but he won't tremble in front of this powerful man. And it throws Haman into a rage. He's filled with wrath. He's filled with rage at Mordecai. We can picture the red face of Haman as he walks by Mordecai, perhaps uttering something like this under his breath. Doesn't he know who I am? Has he forgotten that I hold the signet ring of the king whenever I want to? How dare he defy me? And Mordecai has taken the proverbial pin and stuck it into Haman's helium balloon. And the narrator takes the reader on a brilliantly takes us on a ride of a roller coaster ride of Haman's emotions. He's up and then he's down. And it's time for an unholy huddle. It's time to put some helium back into Haman's balloon. And how does he do that? He assembles his wife and his friends, doesn't he? Verse 10. He begins to read off his resume. He begins to list 1, 2, 3, 4 things that ought to impress them about him. And hey, wait a minute, there's also a couple other things you don't know that's hot off the press in regards to me. I got invited to a feast today that was only king and queen, and tomorrow I get to go to another feast that's only king and queen. But this is all empty to me because of this man Mordecai. He becomes a boaster. He becomes a bore. He becomes a braggart. He hasn't read Proverbs 27:2, which is a good word to us in the NIV. Let someone else praise you and not your own mouth. An outsider and not your own lips. Verse 13. Yet all this, all of these great things that are happening in my life, all of these things are worth nothing to me so long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate. All of these good things are dwarfed by this one awful thing. This one guy will not honor me the way he ought to. Ian DeGude, in his commentary, brings up the question, what would godly advice for Haman have looked like? Not that he would have accepted that godly advice. He doesn't receive godly advice. I don't think he's interested in godly advice. But let's go here for a moment because it's helpful. Maybe questions like this. Haman, how does Mordecai's response either way enhance or diminish your personal significance? Why is Mordecai renting so much space in your head? And Haman, is it really about your own personal power? Is that the main thing in life? Haman, how does your anger reveal the idols of your heart? Haman, how can you trust God through this scenario? It's all hypothetical. We'll return to it in just a few moments. And ironically, verse 14, as Haman listens to the advice of his wife and friends, he also unwittingly reverses Esther 1:22, that every man be master in his own house. And so here the two most powerful men in the kingdom are listening to and obeying their wives. I want to also just quickly speak a word about the gallows. We think of a place where someone is hung. That really wasn't the picture here. It's actually a big stake on which the person was impaled. Probably brought them up with ropes live and then brought them down on the stake to be impaled. Literally, the JPS translation hits the nail on the head. Let a stake be put up 50 cubits high. By the way, that's 5 feet high. And in the morning, ask the king to have Mordecai impaled on it. Make no mistake about it. This is not only a death, this is a humiliating death, because people will then walk by and say, hey, what's that dude doing up there? Who is that dude? What's he doing up on that stake? Oh, man, that's Mordecai. That's what happens to people who don't respect Haman. That's what happens to people who defy this powerful man. So we're riding the roller coaster, the wife's command. Then, after you've built this gallows and had Haman hung on the gallows, impaled on the gallows, then go joyfully with the king to the feast. We've heard this same solution. Just get rid of your problem and everything's going to be okay. And that ought to be really suspicious advice to us, because we're just not that content, are we? One problem is eliminated and another one pops up. So if we're going to be on an emotional roller coaster based on our problems, we're in a world of hurt. We need the stability of saying, come what may, it is well with my soul, don't we? Let's think for a moment about Christ. Actually, before we go there, I want to just read from this commentary by DeGude about Haman and his idol. Haman is a case study in what happens in our hearts when idols are challenged. He had made public recognition his idol, and the result was that as long as he was receiving adulation, he felt great. However, when the achievement of his goal was challenged, he responded by lashing out in rage and seeking to feed his idol through boasting. There was a void at the center of his life that no amount of success could fill. He discovers, could have discovered what was driving his life. His rage was an opportunity to discern the condition of his heart, to uncover what was filling the God-shaped hole in the center of his life. The reign of his idol was being challenged by the day's events. We also deal with our idolatries by feeding them rather than starving them. We end up emptier than ever, in even greater bondage than before. And the counsel that Haman received led him nowhere. And our hearts face, he says, the same temptation to bow to idols, whose identities are likewise most easily exposed by analyzing our strongest emotions, both good and bad. What is it that causes us to be angry out of proportion to the offense? There is a clue that one of our idols is being threatened. What is it that makes us feel an unusually strong sense of achievement? A balanced sense of achievement is a good thing, but an unusually strong and prideful sense of achievement, that's an indicator of an idol. It may be one of our idols being stroked. Our strong emotions are clues enabling us to read our own hearts better. I thought that was really well put. Well, let's think about Christ for a moment, and then we're going to spend a little bit of time in application. Esther, a sinning, fallen human being, takes steps of faith into a dark corridor of risk/reward. The risk is her own death. The reward is the salvation of her people from slaughter. Jesus, the perfect God-man, stepped into a dark corridor of certain death, with the certainty, if he could persevere and suffer the cross, of saving his people from their sins. Haman built a gallows with the hope of publicly shaming Mordecai by impaling him on it and displaying his body for all to see. Jesus was lifted up on a Roman cross, symbol of shame in that culture, the symbol of, we're going to make an example out of this guy. This is what happens to people who defy King Caesar. And his shameful death on the cross is what saves us from our sins. This made-for-TV book, the Book of Esther, this episode ends at another cliffhanger. It says, this idea pleased Haman, and he had the gallows made. It's dark and foreboding. Does it look good for Mordecai? If you didn't know how the story ended, you would be on the edge of your seat. You couldn't wait to get back into this building next Sunday to hear what comes next. So pretend with me that you don't know. And come back and find out what happens and how the next cliffhanger is resolved. How then shall we live? Three questions. How then shall we live? In what ways is God calling you to step out in faith today, and what makes it difficult to take these steps of faith? Perhaps he's telling a couple to adopt a child. Perhaps to adopt a child from overseas. And that's become very difficult. Perhaps he's called you to take the steps of faith to lovingly and truthfully confront a friend. To take a missions trip, to move to Poland, to be able to minister as Hannah Southwell is doing, to be able to minister to refugees, to break off a romantic relationship that isn't God-centered and isn't God-honoring. To give money that you can't spare to a worthy ministry. Or to share the gospel with someone at the risk that they might reject you, they might sever the friendship. Steps of faith. Secondly, we can't give Haman godly counsel, but we can give each other godly counsel, can't we? And what does that look like in different situations? I'll let you work that one out throughout the week. You'll have plenty of opportunities in your life coming up this week. Third question, how does our ungodly anger reveal to us the idols of our hearts? What evokes the most emotion out of you? It's different probably for you than for me. It's different probably for your spouse. No, you do not get to talk to me. I always shut my phone off except for today. Sorry about that, folks. When God said, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and you shall love your neighbor as yourself, he was hitting at the issue of the idols of our hearts. I'm going to ask Jeff and the praise team to come at this time and to lead us in a final song. As they're coming, I'm going to say a quick prayer of thanks to God for his wonderful word. God, we thank you that Esther could take steps of faith. And we're even much more thankful that Christ took steps of faith and trust in you to commit his body and soul and spirit into your hands as he faced the wrath of God there on the cross. Help us with our many idolatries. Help us to navigate our own lives in a more effective and wise way, to be more controlled by your Spirit. Help us to raise the good questions. Help us to give wise and godly counsel to each other and take the steps of faith in those areas where we're not so sure, but we are sure that you're leading us to take those steps. May we look to you in these things. Guide and bless and keep us. Bring us back here next week to hear more of your word from the book of Esther. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. So as Pastor Dan was preaching, I was just thinking about this idea that, you know, if we perish come what may, right? And, you know, we look out at this world, especially this month, and we see the perversity, we see just the abominations of against God, and the stand that we are called on to take. And there may be a time where, man, if we perish, we perish. That persecution, family, is coming. It's already here. And if you're in the workplace, you know it, you sense it, you're the odd duck out, right? I mean, it's all around us, and it's like encroaching more and more just how quickly this all has come about. And so as we close, we're going to sing one more time, Solid Rock. We will stand on that solid rock, and one day we will stand before the throne of God. And what a day it will be when we are standing there, all of us together, and I'm giving Craig the thumbs up, and Alan is, we're fist bumping, and we're looking, and I'm high-fiving my wife because we look, and by the grace of God, all our kids made it, right? What a glorious day it will be. But in the between, now and then, let us stand on the solid rock of Jesus Christ. Go ahead and stand with me one more time.
than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Jesus' name. When darkness seems to hide in space, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.
All other ground is sinking.
Peace.
great day. We're going to go ahead and hold back. We've got a church business meeting, so everybody is welcome to stay, so you can sit back or you're free to go. Just going to be handling some church business this morning, so please be seated, those of you who would like to stay, and yeah, over to you, man.
Thank you, Jeff. We're going to take a vote this morning to accept five new members into membership, and the elders have met with these folks and recommend them for membership. Before we take that vote, I'll just tell everybody that we've got another membership class starting up on July 10th, and if you're interested in joining, you can see an elder or a pastor or just sign up for this class. But today, we're going to welcome five new members. And if we could, we'll go back to an older practice of asking you to come down front so people can come by and greet you, if you're comfortable with that. If you're not comfortable with that, don't do it. But the five members that we are recommending are Roger and Sue Leach. And if you're comfortable, come on down. If you're not, that's all right. Sally Milam. Sally here? Yep. And Nathan and Jessica Priest. So our Constitution does require a membership vote, and we're going to take a voice vote. So all those, first we have to get a second. The elders are making a nomination, and we need a second. And I saw Terry Williams seconding this motion. And so now we're ready to take a vote. All those in favor of accepting these five into membership, please say yes.
Yes.
Any opposed, please say no. Thank you. This membership meeting is adjourned, but please come by and meet and greet our new members. Thank you.